What we're looking for is super mega positivity. Super mega positivity. Yeah, we got these signs. Maybe we should hold these signs on the street like this. And, hey, come on. Right. Yeah. All right. Very great. Super mega positivity. Super mega dini positivity. Now, what we want is an ambience, an overall ambience. This is what really works. This is what really works. Three hundred and sixty degree super mega positivity. 360 degree innocence. Super mega positivity. Remember to laugh, to have this ambience. Don't allow it to get into your thinking. Neither frivolous nor thinking, you might say. There's a light seriousness to it. It's an ambience. Now, as we're going towards the May 27th, where we start to enter into the next phase of this nightmare dream we're having of a world, we don't want to peak. We don't want to peak. We want to just keep striding with super mega positivity. Don't try to peak, because when you try to peak, you're getting away from full stop and the wow, whereas full stop and the wow is the essential practice for success. And in full stop and the wow, what we're doing is we're being humble and meek and saying, I don't have, right now, I don't have this peak capability in my actions, peak capability in my thinking, peak capability at all. I accept less than optimal peak functionality so that I can let this continuity fear burn off. This is why humility, meekness and humility is the key to the path. This is super important, super mega important. This really means full stop in the wow, where you're so shocked by your success, for a while you're not functioning in a peak way. You're still functioning fine, it's just not in a peak way. So the idea that we have to peak at any particular point, then that stops our progress, because we say, oh, if I go into the wow, I won't peak, so I'm going to block any insight that might arise that bring a wow, so I can peak. This is the trouble. The other trouble is using stimulants. The sex, drugs, rock and roll thing is ruinous to the path, because what you have to do is you have to be aware of your nervous reaction, your nervous system, your psyche, your reaction, and you have to catch it before it goes too far, and then insist on the wow, full stop in the wow. You're in control of that. You can control your nerves that way, actually. But if you are on stimulants of various types, you will override that awareness and you'll think, no, I can keep going, I can do more. And you do too much, and then the backlash is overwhelming and you lose your confidence, and then you become paranoid, you become brittle, all this stuff. You can't do it that way. You have to be aware, okay, how much is this affecting my nervous system, this insights? How badly? Now, perfect example is these new practices, which I can understand why they're only given out to those who are very advanced on the path. However, it's sort of self-regulating, because those who are not really advanced won't do the practices. And they'll go, oh, that's crazy, I don't want to do that. But this idea of pus, you know, oh God, it's just aversion therapy, really. Well, today I did more of that. And you have to be aware of how much is enough, and until you go into this point where, wow, that's enough. And then you have to stop it. This is what you have to do on the path, is you have to be aware of how much is you reached a point where that's enough, and then you go into the wow, and you're humble and meek, and you realize, okay, for a little while here, I'm not going to be peak functioning in a peak way. Of course, the ego hates that. It says, no, you got to try to reach the peak. No, we don't try to reach the peak. Okay, we try to. Well, the peak with the glimpse has already happened, and now we're not struggling to get back to it. We're now allowing it to sink in and are managing our success. We reach the peak, we look around, and then, wow. And then you manage that wow. The ego say, no, now you gotta function peak. Well, if you try to function a peak way, you'll actually be at conflict with yourself, at war with yourself, because you won't allow these glimpses to take place. You'll keep trying to refine what you've already seen. This is the problem. Don't try to refine anything. Don't try to refine anything. I made some great lemonade today. Really, it was awesome. And used cane sugar, just cane sugar, charcoal distilled water, and fresh lemon juice. And it tasted great. Tasted great, and I was singing all day. But not reaching a peak, see? Wasn't trying to reach a peak. Now, when you have this attitude, the peaks will come automatically because you can handle them. So you'll get these glimpses. I just had a number of glimpses just before I started taping here. And I'm getting more and more and more and more and more. Okay, so it's all smoothing out. It's all smoothing out. And this is what's important. The insights will come on their own when you are ready to handle the insights. So it's not about struggling for insights so much. It's about the right ambience, the right attitude, the right determination, the right willingness to be humble and meek, and the flipping of the script will come. It will come. And when you see it, say, oh, that's just right. Oh, I just, and I'm super mega smart. You say, no, wait a minute. I'm super mega wowed by this. So let me just get used to the fact that now I know how to flip the script. So this is the key. If you're on stimulants, if you're not really stone cold sober, you will miss the fine line. You'll miss the fine line. You have to recognize there's a fine line here, and it comes with more you practice, the more you start to recognize it. It's like you're walking a tightrope. You got to know when to stop, because it starts getting swaying too much. You start swaying too much, you say, okay, I better stop and let's stop the swaying here. And then you stabilize yourself, and then you go on some more. But if you're on drugs, sex, drugs, rock and roll trip, you'll miss it. You'll miss the fine line. You won't know where to find it. And that's when you start getting very insecure, and then you start acting out that insecurity, and that's when the wheels come off. You go on some, ego, spiritual ego trip, paranoid trip, anger trip, all sorts of different side trips that you want to stay away from, because coming back from those is really difficult. It's terrible. That's why I'm so relentless in just this full stop in the wow. Don't want any side trips. Had enough side trips. So when we get the answer, we say, okay, I'm capable of seeing the answer. And look at it that way. Don't struggle. Say, what was the answer? Well, if it's not right in front of your mind easily, that means the wow is there. Okay. So pay attention to the wow. And you say, I just got a super mega insight. Super mega positive insight. I've been getting them all day long, actually. Singing very well too. That lemonade helped me. But mostly I'm starting to get my endurance back and starting to get a little bit better in shape and able to just harmonize at will and just spontaneously and with all sorts of different types of structures and harmonies. Just whatever I feel like doing. And it's just there. The voice is there. As long as I don't try to push it too much. Same thing with the path. You'll find the not answers, but the recognition, the recognition will start coming more and more and more, and you just say, oh, okay, you know, and just you just get used to it, and stay humble and meek. The really the way to express it is so different what the ego has just trained us into. We can't seem to find it. Because we think, well, that doesn't help anybody. See, we're trying to find an enlightenment that fits in with what the ego wants to question and relate with. And that's not enlightenment at all. So the ego looks right past it, says, no, I need to ask questions of somebody who's enlightened. You know, what do you mean you need to ask questions? Enlightenment is the realization you don't need to ask any questions. And giving out answers isn't it. Enlightenment is realization giving out answers isn't it at all. Something to that effect. Enlightenment is the answer. There isn't any other answer. At any rate, what's more important is full stop, keep practicing this, and don't try to peak as we go towards May 27th. Don't try to peak. Just keep your habits going along like I'm trying to do. Refrain from some desperate gambit, right? Don't be desperate. Be confident. Be calm, be confident, don't be desperate. I continue to get many, many, many pointers to June and July. It's like, uh-oh. Yeah. It's going to be very profound coming up. Very profound. So we just count on the work we've done. You can count on the work here that I've done. I feel confident in that. And we will be able to count on an ambience, a super mega positive ambience, and just relax into that 360 degree ambience. Just try that. Think of just relaxing into a 360 degree ambience. I don't want Google picking up this music. Okay. Otherwise, they'll flag the video. Now, with this aversion therapy, I find I could do it, and it's super helpful. It's amazing what has happened. But I cannot completely understand how not everyone will take to that, so that's fine. You just keep doing the full stop on the wow, and all the right insights will arise for you, all the right recognitions will just automatically arise. They're already there within you. You don't have to put them there. They're already there. You just have to let them emerge. That's all. See, truth is already within us. We just have to allow it to emerge. Now, this aversion training went from bodies, body parts to bodies, and then to nature, and then the world, the whole world. Wow, that was very intense. I saw the ocean, just an ocean of pus, abhorrent pus, and the whole world was just pus. I was like, I've got to be up above that. It was very intense, but I found I could keep breathing and stay calm. at the same time. Quite interesting. But you have to be very confident and very have great faith to do this. Otherwise, you're going to lose your nerve. You might call it therapy. This is a strong one. But since doing this, there have been tremendous breakthroughs, super mega breakthroughs, actually. There have been super mega breakthroughs. Yes, there have been. It was just coming across this sign. It was a sign of a very, super mega breakthrough as well. Yeah, so it's been a very, very intense day, super mega intense day from the get-go, And I've been battling to stay in the wow all day long. This is what you can do. You can literally have days like this where the whole day is a super challenge, a super mega challenge to just stay in the wow, because the what's arising is just so amazing. You really have to stay focused. And this is a great thing. The challenge to stay focused means you're meeting with all this success. So the answers to abidance are arising. They absolutely are arising. And you have to, don't grab a hold of them. Just act like you've been there before. Say, okay, oh, good, okay, yeah. That's arising now, okay, wow. Don't be desperate. See, the truth's already within us. We can't escape from it. So it's not like we're dead. How can we be desperate? We already have it. How can we be desperate for what we already have? So act like you already have it. Act like, oh yeah, this is mine. This is always with me. This is always with me. All of this wisdom is always with me. That's what I am. I don't have to get this. I don't have to acquire it. I can't lose it. I can't throw it away. I can symbolize it and throw a symbol of it away. Like a golden ring or something. You can symbolize wisdom and throw it away. But it's just a symbol. You haven't thrown it away. Now, here is a visualization that it will be very helpful. We're getting these skillful means now, coming from the grace of God. And it's very, very helpful. We are not impoverished when it comes to skillful means at all. We're not beggars here, okay? At all. Keep this in mind. At this point, we are not beggars. I'm not going around saying, I have to find some skillful practice, skillful means. I'm really, really don't have any idea what can work. No. We're the opposite of beggars. We're super enriched, actually, with very skillful means. Imagine a body. Say a body, and imagine the world. Okay, we're used to thinking there's a body in the world. The two are separate. But now imagine a body and a world, and you see them as just one whole. They're not two things, just one thing. Body world is just one image. Body world is just one image. And then imagine just a pus body, if you can, if you want to. And that pus body in the world are also just one image. So you can set the entire image down. all at once. It's not two images that sit down, it's one image. We're so used to separating out body and world as two images. It's actually just one image, practicing it as one image. And therefore the setting down is instantaneous, is it not? There's no time involved, really. It's already set down. In fact, all images are just one image. It's all just one image, actually. The whole situation is just one image. So seeing it all as one, all is the same, just one image, not many separate images. This is one of the integral keys to abidance. Now these practices just arise within my mind. They just arise. And when I go and look and dig through history, you see, is this arisen before? Sometimes yes, sometimes no. But I realize that this is how it happens. If you're really dedicated and you really put in the effort and you're really grounded and the wow, these skillful practices will just arise in your mind and you'll just become aware of them just like that. This is what's happened historically. They can say, well, you know, so such and such deity visited it. They have a way of deifying in a form way the qualities of perfection and freedom and reality and natural mind and all that to help them visualize it and transfer their belief that my mind is just like this. It's just, these are just expedients. And so they will say, well, this deity delivered this skillful means to me. But you could say that, or you could say the Holy Spirit, or you could say just the truth within me. Truth is within, is everywhere. It's within all. So it arises into our mind stream, or our attention stream, because it's within it. It's, we are that. We're just pretending that we're not. So when the truth arises, it seems, oh, natural. And then you take a look at the ego, and from the ego standpoint, it's so awkward and unnatural, and you start thinking about it, and then that's when you lose the insight. So when the insight arises, just say, okay, I can get used to that. This can be my familiarity, my comfort zone. So let's just 360-degree relax and don't struggle, don't stress, don't strain. ...360-degree ambience of understanding, of not understanding, but acceptance and recognition. Recognition. So how do I feel now? Well, I feel kind of nervous. Okay, wow, I'm nervous because I just saw how to... You know, I just saw the answer, and I realized the world, the ego in the world, even though it's right in front of their faces, they look right past it. Now, speaking of that, if I can look at this, the truth is inexplicably clear, right? It's inexplicably clear. So when we can accept that it's inexplicably clear, that's when we'll see it. But I saw it just a little while ago that the mind is seeing is what we call the clear light. And what it is that the sunlight, energy light, you might call it, is no longer, you don't allow it to obscure your mental seeing. It's still present. I mean, you can, like a shadow, you can be aware of it like that, but it's not obscuring at all the spaciousness. The mind actually sees the clear light spaciousness. It actually sees it. That's all. Very, very simple. Super simple. The sensory perception is like a blindfold. It's like it seems to obscure just mental seeing. Real seeing is the mind seeing, actually. And the mind could see right past all energy, light, that type. So as if it isn't even there at all. It's not even there in terms of a reality. It's there like a mirage, but it doesn't fool the mind. It can see the spaciousness of everything. Everything is just all ornamentation. It's just like one image, really. It's just all an image. The whole thing's just one image. Symbols are just an image. They're not, they all are like the world, everything on the world. Imagine instead of all these separate stuff, it's just one world, people, things, vegetation, animals. It's all just one image. The whole thing is just one image. Not many. And then you see it as just intrinsic spaciousness instead of light and energy, solar energy, bouncing off of everything, reflecting off of everything. It's really simple. Very, very simple. I just saw it, how simple it is. I said, oh, that's easy. And this is the so-called emptiness. This is this term that just, you know, just, you hear it everywhere, in Buddhism especially, everyone's talking about. This is just what it means. It's empty of solar reflection, energy light reflection. It's empty of that. Okay? It doesn't need that. The mind doesn't need that to see at all. It sees the clear light of everything. So it's really super mega simple, actually. That's all they're getting at. You know, all this teaching and religion, etc., it's way more complicated than it needs to be or should be. Because we're all confused, and we sort of developed all this complex around it all, but it's actually extremely simple. In fact, enlightenment's unavoidable. Anything at all will work, actually. As far as what's the answer, any answer is good enough. Whatever you like. Everything is the path. Any answer is good enough. You see, this is the super positivity ambience. When you talk this way, when you have this ambience, this is what really works. And just think of it, get relaxed into a 360 degree ambience. So nothing is predominating, okay? Nothing is predominating. Maybe you have questions and answers, but those are not predominating. It's a 360 degree equality, you know, radiance, to relax into that. It's an ambience, a presence, 360 degree ambience. See, be meek and humble enough to be quiet. This is really the key. This meekness, this humbleness, this mood of repentance, I call it. Mood of repentance. You just stay in that mood of repentance. If you want the fast track, stay in the mood of repentance. Because when you get these insights, you know, you realize, wow, I'm already enlightened, actually. I am an enlightened being naturally. I'm not obscured by solar light at all. What I am is not even touched by it. I'm not in the slightest bit obscured by it. This whole universe is an attempt to obscure what we are. I'm not obscure. I can't be obscured. Say that. I cannot be obscured at all. There's just one image that doesn't obscure at all. What happens is when we get lost in trying to compare symbols or compare comparative images and fail to see it's all just one image, we get caught up in comparisons. And that's when our mind gets all foggy and confused. There's nothing to compare. There's just one image. There's nothing to compare it with. Just one reflection, isn't it? Isn't it not just one reflection? And yet we divide it up like it's a whole bunch of separate reflections. The light hits the world and bounces back. Isn't that just one reflection? Overall, just an overall reflection? Is there really a seam somewhere, actually? And we think, oh, there's a house, and there's a tree reflection, and this reflection. But isn't it just actually just a reflection? Just one reflection? A road is there. But that's all being reflected. Isn't it being reflected simultaneously? Concurrently? In terms of reflection, is there a house, a tree, these various things in a linear way? Is it linear or is it holistic, the reflection? Don't try to answer, just relax into 360 degree ambience. The raising of this question is part of the ambience, okay, that you're relaxed into. The ambience allows this pointer to be brought up. Just say, is it? So when we shift and see it's just all one reflection, then we're in a different state of mind, aren't we? Our perception is quite different. It's holistic. Then abidance comes naturally, shouldn't it? I mean, there's just one reflection there. I'm abiding in recognition of this. So this is, you know, touching on a very touchy area in our psyche, isn't it? I can feel it. So you could feel the wow. This is like, oh my gosh, maybe I've been misperceiving this entire time. Yes. Interestingly enough, when we make this shift in perception, it's like our entire life is redeemed. It's like all of our life comes alive. So we think we've been born, we've been aging, and I was invited to some 60th anniversary of being turning 60 today, and it's like, wow, you know, this is passed me by, and I missed it all, and I missed so much. But when you make this shift in perception, this is what I'm I got a sort of a glimpse of it today, so I'm speaking from this standpoint. It's your entire life is redeemed. It all is present. You never missed anything. Because the wholeness that is right now has always been present. And you're seeing it right now. And so all of those attempts to not see it were to no avail. You see what I'm saying? All the effort to not see this ended up as failure, futile, which is great. And so your entire life is redeemed. You didn't have any failure in your life at all. You're a complete success. And so everything you did in your life, you now look at it as just steps to total success. And so the success was there all the way along. It's very, very redemptive. Amazing. We start regretting our lives. I say, what did I do with my life? You know, I spent so much time watching baseball games and, you know, sports, listening to sports and listening to music. All this, you know, too much time listening to music. What did I do? Was I crazy? But then looking at it from the standpoint, flipping the script, when we succeed, we realize, no, all of that was just part of my success. We can get lost in studying different, you know, various religions, traditions, and history. What we need to do is just relax into 360-degree presence, ambience, right now. There's no different truth within someone from the past, you know, historical, than there is with us right now. It's exactly the same. The reflection has always been one. The image has always been one. That holistic way of seeing has always been there for us. Now, when we think we're going to run into somebody who's going to ask us a tough question and trip us up, what that really is our own projection of our own continuity fear, hoping that this will happen. See, we project it out, and of course, if we do project it out, it will happen. But if we allow the continuity fear to evaporate, guess what? The question evaporates. This inner locutor that we fear is going to ask us, trip us up and ask us some really tricky question, that disappears. And you see, I don't even need that. I don't need that defense mechanism. That's one of my main defense mechanisms. I say, okay, I'm enlightened, but then what if someone comes along and asks me this question like this and puts me on the spot and I'm going to lose it, you know, like that. No, what I'm doing is saying I kind of want to lose it now because I'm nervous about the continuity fear. So I'm trying to project that outside of myself and say somebody else is trying to trip me up or will trip me up. So that's why it's important, full stop, and don't struggle trying to answer this questioner. Just realize this is what's happening. Stay humble and meek. Don't struggle to answer it. So the real answer is just stay humble and meek along the way. And when enlightenment's ready to emerge, it will emerge. That's all. And just stay humble and meek. And manage our successful, stop in the wow. Just do that. And whatever it is that you need to see, it will arise for you. And you'll feel it's a unique, slightly unique to you, the way you approach it. Again, answers are everywhere. Everything's an answer. Always are a path of the path. Because reality, truth is already with us. It's inescapable. We can't escape it. So all paths to trying to escape it are equally futile. Right? So that can be recognized. Anything you're doing can be recognized. Oh, that's futile. See? The path, oh, that's futile. This is futile. That's the path, recognizing it's all futile. We can't escape what we are. So the path is just the path of recognizing futility for what it is. And futility is all around us. Everything we're trying to do here is futile. Just about in the world. So anything at all, it can be the spark to recognize futility. Say, oh, and then I don't need to do that. I don't need to do it. I don't even need to try that. And commitment to sitting still is so important, so you don't feel you embarrass yourself without, you know, with a lack of peak performance, peak functionality. You're not doing anything. You're just sitting still. And so you feel safe, kind of safe this way. And you're committed to no action, and you know, no explanation. You're just sitting quiet. And so you're not going to embarrass yourself. So you can have this intense wow and feel comfortable with it. This is what is key, really key. This is just a super pragmatic, effective exercise, the way to go like this. Because we sabotage ourselves thinking that, okay, now I got an answer, now I got to go out and be some peak performer right now. And then this freaks us out, and we try to bury it, and especially bury any new stuff coming up, any further realization, you know, or deepening of it. Because we think that'll interfere with our peak functionality. So commit to this humility, humble. Relax into that. Say, oh, the ambience, 360-degree ambience. Don't project success. Don't project failure. Don't project at all. Mahamudra, what does Mahamudra mean? It means everything that arises vividly, very vivid, without any concept or simple label, definition, anything like that. Just extraordinarily vivid, Mahamudra. The great vividness, obviousness, apparentness, self-evidentness. This is healed perception. Mahamudra, it just means healed perception. All these Sanskrit terms, all this stuff, they're just pointing to the obvious, the simplicity, the simple obviousness of it all. Just nothing special or important about any particular label. Like, you know, it's the same. Just keep it very, it's super mega simple. It's beyond meaning. It's 360 degree presence. It doesn't mean anything. Freedom doesn't mean anything. It's freedom. See, there's no reflection. We're so used to reflected light. We keep trying to find the reflection. But in real vision, we're seeing the thing as it is, without any reflection, reflecting light. We see reality, the isness of it, instead of a reflection, as if there's some two-ness. And we're looking at the reflection and trying to take that as what is real. We've romanticized spiritual path and attainment and all this in so many ways for so long. We've lost track of just the mundane simpleness of it. It is completely mundane, completely simple. When you see it, you can't hardly believe it. So what, we spent all this time, wasted our time looking for this? What? As Rama Maharshi would say, what an astonishment. He said, it's so simple. It's right here in front of your face. And we've spent all these religions and exercise, all this, and it's just right here. It's how astonishing. It's 360 degree here. There's nothing excluded. So the question is, what shall we exclude? The answer is nothing at all. Oh, you mean truth is nothing? No, that's it. There's nothing excluded from it. So everything is there. You can't find what to exclude. Nothing is, everything's inexcludable. Totally inexcludable, cannot be excluded. How can anything be excluded from its own intrinsic spaciousness? And in not struggling to peak, we find that we will peak. It's almost a paradox, actually. Because this not struggling is the peak, actually. Enlightenment is not a struggle. There's no struggle. Our natural mind, there's no struggle. The key is don't project into the future. Don't project success into the future. Okay? And then chase after it. This is what keeps us chasing after it. Projecting in the future out of continuity fear, then chasing after it. There's nothing to be found in the future about what's here right now. Nothing to be added. Nothing doesn't add anything at all. The future doesn't add anything at all. Just like the past also doesn't add anything at all to now. Doesn't subtract either. Doesn't add nor subtract. Doesn't do anything to it. Because everything is here right now. Intrinsic spaciousness is here right now. All potentiality is here right now. So how can we add anything to that? So again, 360-degree ambience. We're hearing with this 360-degree ambience. We're not hearing it just with our thinking, or reacting or anything. No, so it's just relaxing, and we're hearing it with 360-degree ambience. So this smile is here, sense of humor is here, spontaneity is here, creativity is here, sobriety is here, determination is here, everything is here right now. 360-degree ambience is all here right now. Thinking about a future doesn't add anything to what's here right now. And don't think about a future of that either. Truth is entirely here right now. But don't struggle with that. I got a glimpse. So you got a glimpse? Okay. Good. Wonderful. Stay relaxed in the ambience. Cold here in California. It's supposed to rain tomorrow. Boy, what a weather change. It's been rough, actually. We're not really used to May being like this. And had a hard time with today. The cold, the wind, the glare. It felt like, what is this, winter? It's weird. I find that this aversion therapy, knocking out attraction to the flesh, which means the world, right? I mean, isn't the body part of the world? Come on, is it? Yeah, of course it is. We keep thinking it's something separate or different from the world. No, everything arising here is just all one arising, actually. That's it, it stopped. Okay, it's going again. All right, sometimes it stops. It's just all one arising like this. So to use this practice of aversion, see it all as this, and you recoil from it. You jump back from it. And when you recoil from the world, your attraction to the flesh and to valuing it, this is greatly helpful for clarity about realization, recognition to arise. Greatly helpful. This is what I'm experiencing. So Longchenpa prepared me for this Vajrayogini dynamic of this aversion training. Very advanced training. He's renowned as this great friend of the Dakinis in this aspect. It's interesting. I read today there's like two divisions of like skillful means. Tantra really means skillful means. And it's the father and the mother. There's two different types. And it's very interesting, the difference between the two. And I looked, I read the difference. I said, well, I'm definitely the mother tantra, which is cultivating brilliance, clear light and brilliance of mind, focusing that. Whereas the father tantra skillful means focus on bliss, more on bliss, the great bliss. So I said, oh, that makes sense. Okay, I never realized that. That's really the male-female thing, is really what they're just saying, is that there's different focuses. It's they call it mother-father just to differentiate. You could use any label you wanted to. You could call it yin and yang. You could call it Humpty and Dumpty, whatever you want to call it. But there's sort of different. Some like it this way and some like it that way. Some feel more comfortable. And Longchenpa brought me the long day, the great spaciousness, the great clear, the clear light, the brilliance of our true nature, the brilliance of it, the beauty and the brilliance. So that feels very natural to me. They call it more the path of devotion, but this is a loose term. Devoted to the brilliance, devoted to the clarity, devoted to the clear light. Yeah, I've always approached it in that way. So as soon as I would want to practice aversion, it's easy for me now. I just imagine the entire ocean is just all this hideous pus. And immediately my mind recoils from that. No. I don't want to think about the world. No. So it really gets your mind off the world in a powerful way. Now, most are afraid for that to happen, but I'm not. I love it. And you almost become frantic. You do become frantic, get your mind off the world. But I still have this calm and composure. It doesn't bother me, really, in terms of functionality or anything. So I'm able to handle this technique, this type of skillful means. And skillful means are actually everywhere. And it just will arise within you, you know, what to do. Grace will bring your attention to it. Oh, yeah. It interferes with mental imagery of bodies and the world and everything. Just view it as this separating pus bucket. You know, it just immediately my mind recoils from that, and just instantly it stops the imagery. You say, I'm not going back to that. No way. So it's intentional aversion training. It's not being forced upon me. I'm embracing it and saying, I love this. This is great, very effective. why didn't I do that before? Well, it's that way always on the path. Why didn't I do that before? Again, full stop in the wow. You don't think that way. You know, we're here right now with this. So this is what we're focused on. That's all. And we're just wowing this. And if there's some like sweet voice or something trying to seduce you, just imagine the sound of a rattlesnake. I don't want to hear it. Wow, I don't want to hear that. Immediately stops. And again, you won't do this unless you're really ready to embrace it. And otherwise, you'll just say, oh, I don't want to do that. It's terrible. Oh, are you kidding me? For me, I love it. It's great. It's strong medicine. That is for sure. But this is exactly what we need, is strong medicine, right? That's what I asked for. I asked for strong medicine. I got it. And think of any sort of fragrance or perfume as like rotting eggs or something like that, or just an outhouse. Just go, get away from you. Just stay away. You see how you can begin to associate. Awful. Oh gosh, I don't. That's a really powerful one. It's like running up a hill or something. It just gets your legs, just burns you. You get to the top, you just say, oh, that's just brutal. But you know you did something really good. You're really getting in shape this way. So you accept it. Say, oh, that's wonderful. That was a blast. I love that. It's very, So this is using your imagination idol in a positive way of knocking out all this constant mental activity we're doing of thinking about this body situation, this world situation, this storyline of this body. Just knocks it out. I don't want to see bodies at all. Holy kid, I don't want to even see the world at all. This world of reflected light is just as hideous. It's like living in the just pus with a stench of an outhouse and rattlesnake sound to it all. And just, it gets into your nerves and you just say, I don't want that. That's why they practice in charnel grounds, favorite practice, and they've either external one or internally. They just imagine that every time they start thinking about how nice the world is, they just look at these rotting corpses. It's just the world's a terrible place. Are you kidding me? It is actually. I mean, we're not making this up. It's a terrible place. It's death. It's death based. It's death based. It's hideous. But we're intentionally, bringing up an aversion to it. instead of just thinking that naturally some sort of aversion will ultimately, well, yeah, if that takes a long time, we can speed it up this way. I had this frame, picture frame online, and I was trying to look for one for Vajrayogini. I found a really good one, actually. Maybe I'll put the picture into it. It's a beautiful red frame with a red Ferrari, symbolizing, you know, this is her thing, speeding it up really, really fast. Super mega speed up. Super mega speed up, right? Yes, indeed. Red tends to symbolize fast. At least in our culture, red Ferrari, we immediately say, ah, you know, that's a fast car. It goes really fast. And so the lady in red is here to speed things up, to go help us go fast, really fast. So if we can just accept this and say, this is the times we live in right now, where going really fast is where it's at. You know, the ego's playing hardball with us. So guess what? We're playing hardball right back. Vajrayogini wears this garland of skulls. Well, what she's saying, people give different interpretations, but she's saying, look, this world's nothing but death. So look upon death. Look at, when you try to look at the world, just see death. And this will really wake you up. So this is actually what's going on here. It's just camouflaged. The world is just constantly drinking blood, is it not? Isn't it drinking everyone's blood constantly? Yes, it is. It's a blood-sucking planet, actually. This planet's like a vampire. Go into a hospital and you get freaked out. Really? I don't even want to think about it at this point. You talk about aversion training. Maybe that started it for me. Kickstarted. It happened, started on April 25th. It was the 25th, I think it was. When I said we needed to start the intensive, that was April 26th. April 26th, I said that the 26th through the May 26th, let's do an intensive. Well, it's happening, and it's happened. It started right then, just this unbelievable aversion training. Oh, my God. It's been continuing now. It's even more intense, aversion training. But this speeds everything up. It's like an electrical shock. If you try to think about something, you recoil from that. The thing is, you have to want to get free of these, you know, all this imagery and flesh. Otherwise, you'll think, oh my gosh, what's going to happen to me? What if I want to go back to that and I have all this aversion to it? Oh, this is too scary. So you won't be able to do aversion training. It's only the fortunate few who can do it. when you're ready for it. We've had enough of this rotting corpse we call the world, actually. It's just a rotting corpse. That's all it is. With pus oozing out everywhere. Just horrible outhouse-like pus oozing out everywhere. The stench, that's what the world really is. Keep in mind, it's just all one image, one imagine, one dream. Don't try to separate out and say, well, this person's alive and that person's in the grave. And no, it's all just one. So you have to look at it that way. And then what do you see then? It's like, oh my gosh, it's hideous. But we don't need to see it actually that way, as far as we can see with our mind and see the isness. Wow, is it late? It's getting pretty late. 111. I said that was 11101. It's all one. So we're trying to get past our sensory perception here, right? So anything our sensory perception suggests to us, an imagery, we apply the aversion technique to it when we're practicing. And then this enables us to get past sensory perception, which is, Jesus says, that's the great block. Sensory perception is really the blindness, he says. It's the blindness that we have. It's a way that we pretend to be blind. It's just all pretense, but we're pretending pretty well. Trying to hang out here as much as possible. But it's a little chilly. And long week, brutal work of week of work. Intense, you know, lack of sleep again. I'm sleeping better, but still not getting enough. The new pillow is working out really well. That's very, very helpful. I was really in desperate straits there for a while. So I'm hanging in there. I hope you're all hanging in there here with us, just 360-degree ambience, 360-degree trust in the great gurus. The great saviors. Trust in the Dharma kings. They know what they're doing in terms of waking us up to recognition. And it's really so simple that that's why we miss it. It's so simple. So stay simple, humble, meek. Simple, humble, meek. Stay this way. Simple doesn't mean dumb. See, we make a conflate, there's a problem there. We think that simple must be real stupid then. No. It's completely ideal. So therefore, it's completely simple, right? There's no questions about it. Enlightenment is unquestionable. My neck is better shape. So I'm in pretty good shape actually, going forward here. Body's tired, very tired, sore, but overall, I'd have to say that I'm hanging in there. In spite of just this massive intensity here, just wires came down our street just for no particular reason. Suddenly, they just collapsed. It's really weird. Just like this computer, it got pulled down yesterday. Suddenly, everything gets pulled down. Something like that. Seems to get a lot of imagery, a lot of situations that are indicating this. Sudden disruption. Code pink. Sudden disruption. I had someone in a dream last night saying, go pink. Code pink is, of course, a movement that they specialize in disrupting public discourse, communication. So maybe we're going to have a disruption in communication coming up. It's quite possible, actually. This seems to be indication. Massive cyber attack possible. Some EMP possible, right? Something is coming. But it got fixed. It got fixed. So this may be a warning, like a earthquake, a precursor quake, where it's big. There's like sort of big earthquake. We go, oh my gosh, that's really bad. But then we recover from it, so that's not so bad. Then there's a second one. I think, oh my, another one. And then the big one comes later. Like there'll be three like earthquakes, like upheavals. And the first two will recover from and think, oh, okay, that was a close call. And then the third one is when really everything falls apart. That's a dream I had. It might have been a prophetic dream showing what's going to come instead of the stuff in the past, like World War One, World War Two. Maybe it's what's going to come. So we might have the grid might go down, and then we'll recover from it. They'll put it back. We'll say, "Oh, that was, wow, that was really scary." And there'll be very possible. Very, very possible. They have like Tesla technology with gravity waves. Oh, I don't know what they do with the planet and stuff. Where they could probably crash. There's probably technology to crash the grid. Really, it could be done on purpose, actually. So there's full stop in the wow. It's a practice. It's a workout. Look at it that way. It's a workout. So take the challenge. Work out. Sit still. Sit quiet. Don't move much. Just don't plan. Don't try to grab anything. Don't recall. Don't project. Don't advance. Don't retreat. Don't make anything of it. And so when the insights come, just say, okay, but stay 360 degree ambience, context, ambience about it. So, okay, if this clarification is playing, just let it play and just stay in the 360 degree ambience. It's really starting to chill here. So I'm going to end this one. And this is where we're at right now. The success is so rapid, so profound. Really have to concentrate on full stop in the wow. Okay. Very great. That's it.